So before you start, what is asymmetric key encryption? I think we all of you know, and it is also called as public key cryptography. So where the encryption key, also called as public key, and the corresponding decryption key, also known as private key, are different, is called as asymmetric key encryption or asymmetric encryption. So here, if you look at this diagram, you can understand the sender encrypting the plain text using a public key, and the output is the cipher data, and which is transmitted to the recipient, and the recipient decrypts it using the private key and gets the decrypted plain text or plain text data, and the recipient can use it and read it. So we understand this concept, right? So private key cryptography, traditional, it is so in previous one, what we have spoken about is public key cryptography. Now think about private key cryptography. So what we have seen previously, they were basically private key cryptography. So they are the traditional, private secret single symmetric key cryptography. Uses one key. So there was only one key used for encryption and decryption both. So that is what also called as symmetric key cryptography, or you can call it as private key cryptography. And the key is shared by both sender and receiver. And system is symmetric here because the same key is used, and parties have equal right over the key. That means the sender and receiver are having equal right, equal access to the key. So what are the problem with private key, so that or private key cryptography, so that we are thinking about public key cryptography. So key issues are, think about a situation if Alice and Bob are at long distance and they want to talk over internet, how they share the key, how will they share the key? So if you think about symmetric key encryption, you need to have a share key. The sender and receiver, Alice and Bob, who are in a long distance, they need to have same key first. Now, how that same key will be exchanged or shared among them? So that is a problem. Now, one solution somebody can give, that if they already met previously, may exchange the key for future use. Yeah, this is a solution, but all the time it is not possible, right? There is many people like we are communicating, but we have never met physically or face to face previously. But we are doing communication in a, using all encryption technique. So this is not a very good idea that they may have met previously and exchange the key for future use. So key may be sent by courier. So another option can come that, okay, you send the key by courier using speed post or some other service. So, but problem is that is not suitable nowadays because it is costly, as well as it needs time, and too many problems are there. So you can rely on it, right? So in the middle way, who are transmitting the courier, they can again open the courier the sorry open the parcel and see what is the key written inside. Okay. Now, how to digitally exchange the key? That is the point of discussion. Alternative to secure channel. That means, okay, if there is secure channel, there is no issue. But what is the alternative? Because a secure channel over internet is almost very hard to find. So if it is a private channel you have created between the two, two distance offices, that can be a private channel, but it is almost impossible over internet. So internet is a public channel. So how digitally we can exchange the key, or Alice and Bob can exchange the key? So does not protect sender from receiver forging a message claiming is sent by sender. That means it also need to assure the digital technique that the receiver can't force the message and can claim, no, you have sent this to me. So that thing should be assured, that either party should not claim that without enough evidence that you have sent this to me. Okay. The another problem is this, if you think about, okay, we still go with symmetric key encryption, and we have n number of people in the communication, in the network, and each person wants the flexibility to communicate with other n minus one people. So in that case also, if you are going to use symmetric key at the beginning itself, this n number of people need to share n square, approximate n square number of keys. So all these are big issues in using private key cryptography or symmetric key cryptography. So answer is public key cryptography, which allow you to share a key or share a message over the public channel without any third party can understand what secret is shared among the sender and receiver. And this number of n square number of keys required, that is also going to be drastically reduced. Okay, so that is the reason we need to move from private key encryption or private key cryptography to public key cryptography. So why public key cryptography? So it is developed to address two key issues. One is the problem of key distribution, how to have secure communication in general without having to trust a KDC, that means key distribution center, with your key. Okay, so if it is a symmetric key encryption, then understand, I have already told you that key need to be exchanged, right? And it can be solution, third solution, it can be a key distribution center. But why should we believe or trust a key distribution center? So that problem goes out in the public key cryptography. Another thing is digital signature. How to verify a message comes intact from the claimed sender, so that this last problem does not protect sender from the receiver forging a message claiming is sent by the sender. So that is going to be assured if you are using a public key cryptography for digital signature, which will allow you to verify a message comes intact from the claimed sender or not. Now here is a puzzle. You can see, suppose Alice and Bob wish to communicate, and Bob can send a message to Alice as follows. First, he creates a large number of puzzles, each of with moderate amount of difficulty. It must be possible for Alice to solve the puzzles with a moderate amount of computation effort. Now the puzzles are in the form of encrypted message, which with an unknown key. The key must be short enough to allow brute force attack, and Bob sends all the puzzles to Alice, who chooses one randomly. There is many n number of puzzles, so Alice does not solve n number of puzzles. What Alice do? Alice basically take one randomly, choose one randomly out of n number of puzzles and solve it. Then the encrypted solution contains an identifier. So when she will solve the puzzle, he will get an identifier as well as a session key. So Alice can communicate back to Bob which puzzle she has solved. Now think about an attacker. Say Bob sends 100 number of puzzles. For an attacker, if he want to know what is the session key Alice and Bob are going to use for the upcoming communication, then what he have to do? What he don't know, he knows all the puzzles. Now another thing, as these puzzles can be solved using brute force and keys are significantly short, that means we can assume the attacker can also solve each of the puzzles. The problem is that Alice will solve only one puzzle randomly chosen out of these 100 puzzles. Okay, and as Bob have all the puzzles, Bob, for Bob it is not an issue that Alice solved which one, immediately when he will get a message back, he can understand. But for, you know, attacker here, the challenge is the attacker need to solve at least all 100 number of puzzles, and after that, he need to brute force again, you know, using the session key. He will get 100 session keys. 100 session keys he have to use to find out which one decrypting the upward communication packets. Okay, so this is the one way we can think about a public key encryption. But even you can say this is not a good way, because say on the spot, immediately, so the attacker can't solve all the puzzles within a legitimate time. So what he will do, he will collect all the communicated packet and he will store it. Later, he will have infinite time to solve all the puzzles and get all the session key and try each of the session key to crack the ciphers. Okay. So later on, maybe Alice and Bob have communicated securely for 2 days, but after 10 days, the attacker can reveal what was the communication. So that is the big issue with this technique. So both parties now have a common key, Alice because she solved a puzzle, and Bob because he sent the puzzle. Any eavesdropper, say Eve, has a harder task that she does not know which puzzle was solved by Alice. So her best strategy is to solve all the puzzles, but since there are so many, this is more computationally expensive for Eve. So this is the way you can think about a public key encryption, and some concept from here also later on we will find this concept is used actually in many places in biometric authentication and all. Okay, so public key cryptography concepts. So first thing is you need one way function. That means if you know the result of the function, you should not be able to reconstruct the original parameter using what this value what you have is generated. Now, as you think, in PKS encryption, public key secure encryption should be easy, but decryption should not be easy. So you understand? It says that encryption should be easy, but the decryption should not be easy. We need some function which is easy to compute but hard to invert. So that is what one property of one-way function. Unfortunately, although there are many injective functions that are believed to be one-way, but theoretically, if you see, there currently do not exist any function that can be proved one-way. Okay, so this is the again a problem. Like here, one example is given, say fx equal to 7x to the power 21, 3x cube, and 13x square plus 1 mod 2 to the power 15 minus 1. So this function that we may think about one-way function, given x, easy to compute, right? If you give a value of x, you can easily compute what is fx, right? But if I give the fx, it is difficult to compute the inverse of the function, right? Because if I give x equal to 2, you will get basically you will get an integer value as a result of fx. Now if I give fx equal to some integer, can you calculate what was the inverse x? So it is very difficult to find out. So we can consider this kind of functions as one way function. So here is the well known expression. That suppose n is product of two large prime number p and q, and let a be a positive integer, then f can be defined like this: zn to zn. That means it is a domain of integer to another domain of integer. Okay. Now if GCD of a and phi n equal to 1, then this in fact the RSA encryption function. Basically, this is what going to be used in RSA encryption. Okay. public key cryptography principles, the use of two keys has consequences in key distribution, confidentiality, and authentication. Okay, because we have two keys, public key and private key. So definitely its consequences will be in key distribution, how you are going to distribute this public key and private key, and how you are maintaining confidentiality of the communication, and how it, you know, we are using this public key for authentication. Okay, so all these things, again, all these things basically gets the benefit of using public key. Okay, key distribution, confidentiality, and authentication, all three things basically gets benefited by public key cryptography. So there it is having basically six ingredients. One is plain text, the encryption algorithm, the key pair, public key and private key pair, and ciphertext and the decryption algorithm. So if you see how this communication happens in asymmetric key encryption, you can understand first a device A gets the device B's public key from the directory. So there will be a directory, okay, which is a kind of public directory anybody can access, or any browser or any device can access this directory. So when, say, like device A is your device and you want to communicate with Facebook, so you need to establish some encrypted encrypted secure communication or channel to communicate. So what you will do, or your device will do, your device will search in the public key store, which can be called as key distribution method mechanism. So here you will search for the public key for the targeted machine or targeted system or device. So you will get, if you get this public key of the targeted device, you take, collect it from here, then use that public key to encrypt your data. Okay, so it will become encrypted text, or you will get cipher text, and as the other people who are trying to attack or who can copy this cipher text will not be able to decrypt this cipher text, because they don't have the private key of the device B, who is the sender here. This red key is the private key. So this red key is not available with anybody else, including the sender. Okay, so it is simply a ciphertext reached to the sender, receiver signed, and receiver uses its private key to decrypt the ciphertext and gets the plain text back. Okay, so this is how the asymmetric key encryption works. Okay, now if you take a small example, like public key, like bank account number, and bank account number, your account number can be public key for you to communicate with the bank, and the PIN what you get later can be the private key for you. So this is a rough example to understand it. So the same thing, I'm not going to explain this diagram. Yeah, so here you can see this key distribution thing, or one device may have public key of multiple people. Okay, so this is a person, let's say Bob. Okay, Bob wants to communicate with Alice, Mike, Jay, and Ted. So Bob may have public key of all these people together, with him. And when he is sending a message to Alice, he will use public key of Alice. When Bob will send the message to, say, Mike, he will use the public key of Mike, and so on. Okay, and decryption will only be possible by the legitimate person who is having the corresponding private key. Okay. Encryption with private key is also possible when you are sending data to multiple people, and all those people need to check out that whether this data was really sent by you. Okay, so it's Bob here. Bob is basically broadcasting some of its document to, say, openly to, say, n number of people. Now, how this all n number of people will verify whether this document was really circulated by Bob? So what happens in that case? Bob encrypts the document using his private key in this case. Okay, in the previous case, you can see that plain text was encrypted with public key of the receiver. But here in this case, you can see the plain text is encrypted with the private key of the sender. Okay, and the receivers will decrypt the encrypted ciphertext using the corresponding public key of the sender. Okay, so here the situation is reverse. When you are using public key encryption, public key cryptography for basically authentication, okay, source authentication, you can say. Okay, now application of public key cryptography are like encryption and decryption techniques, then digital signature and key exchange. Okay. So requirement for public key cryptography are computationally easy for a party B to generate a pair public key, we can write it like KUB, and private key like KRB. So easy for sender to generate the ciphertext and easy for receiver to decrypt the ciphertext using private key. So ciphertext C equal to encryption function E. KUB means that this is the public key and M is message. And on the other hand, it should assure that the decryption function with the help of private key KRB, take the cipher C and able to decrypt it and get back M here. Okay, so this C is can be replaced by this expression Okay, so you get this expression. If this expression is satisfied, then you will say this method is useful for useful as a public key cryptography. Okay, so there is different method of public key cryptographic algorithms. First one is RSA based algorithms, which are basically based on integer factoring and used for key sharing. And electric curve cryptography algorithms, good for smaller bit size and low confidence level compared to RSA. Okay, yes, and very complex. Definitely ECC are quite very complex, and it is example are Diffie-Hellman, Elgamal crypto system are some example of electric curve cryptography. And digital signature standard, that is another algorithm which is called as digital signature standard DSS, make use of SHA-1. So SHA-1 algorithm is a secure hash algorithm, and not for encryption or key exchange. So this is not used for encryption of data or key exchange technique. It is mainly used for digital signature. Okay. Now, message security requirements are disclosure, traffic analysis. So these are the threat. Why do we need message security? Okay, so threats are basically disclosure of the message, then traffic analysis, then masquerade, then content modification, sequence modification, timing modification, source repudiation, and destination repudiation. Now, approaches to message authentication. First one is authentication using conventional encryption, like only sender and receiver should share a key, like you use symmetric key encryption, and when the receiver receives the message, if he gets, if the message is changed or tampered in the communication, then definitely using the decryption key or using the secret key, the receiver will not be able to decrypt the message. So he will understand that, okay, this message is not the original message what was sent by the sender. So this is one way of message authentication, not very good. Okay, then message authentication without message encryption. Now, an authentication tag is generated and appended to each of the messages, like we have seen in our other papers, like data communication or networking. Hash value are added, or CRC values are added to check out whether the message was changed or modified in the communication or not. But still, as message is not encrypted here, it is not a very good one. Then comes message authentication code, like we calculate MAC, okay? Or MAC is the message authentication code as a function of message, and the key can be, you know, written like this: MAC equal to function of you know, K and M. K is the key, and so it uses a key also, secret key K, and the message, and it generates again a kind of not exactly hash, but it is, it takes help of hash and give you some value which is known as MAC. Okay, so this is, you can say, the most secure way of message authentication. Okay, then key management and public key certificate use, almost I have told you about it. Again, you can see here, this one is you know, kind of this one unsigned certificate contains user user ID and user's public key. This is unsigned one. Okay, then what happens to this? It generates a hash of the unsigned message, the original message, okay, which is given by H. Capital H is the hash function, so it gives a hash value. Okay, so this hash value is this one, and you know, this small rectangle is the hash value. Then it uses an encryption function E and a secret key. Okay, using this secret key, it encrypts this hash value again. Okay, encrypt the hash code with and this key is basically the certifying authority's public private key from the signature. So this which generate this key, it comes from the certifying authority, which is a third party, which and it is the private key of the third party. Okay, and it is used to generate the signature. So it is, now we have this small rectangle is the encrypted hash value of the original signature. Now this encrypted hash value of the original signature will be appended to the message, and we will have the signed certificate. Okay, so numbers of time we speak about digital certificate. So this is how the digital certificate is generated. So this one is known as digital certificate, can be verified signature using CS public key.
Yes, sir, got it.
So message authentication. Now it is concerned of message origin authentication, but not confidentiality. So this you have to understand. Message authentication technique itself, if you think it is as a standalone technique, it is concerned about message origin authentication, not confidentiality. Like you was telling that in this authentication technique, this message is not encrypted. Yes, it is not encrypted because it don't care, don't take care of the confidentiality of the message. Now, symmetric key cryptographic technique can be used for this. Okay, then sender and receiver share a symmetric key in that case, and MAC is an encrypted checksum generated. So this MAC is generated here. So we know how to generate the MAC. Then MAC is appended to the message, and it is transmitted. Okay, so this is very important when you are using symmetric key encryption. Okay, then because in symmetric key encryption, every packet you will send, every packet encrypted packet. So this message, if you think about encrypted message, so every time you are sending it, you need to, the receiver need to check out whether the received message is sent by the proper sender. Okay, the legitimate sender. Okay, so similar to hash or fixed length output. So this MAC is similar to hash.